goes to hell.
If you build it, he will come.
Once upon a distant time, early in life's journey, George did find himself lost in the basement of a five and dime. He remembered tearing loose from his mother's hairy hand as the escalator neared the bottom, and although the sign said step up, George's feet remained flat, for he knew curiosity killed the cat, but wasn't he a primate and above all that? Down, down through the floor rode George, nine times his eardrums popped, and when the dissension finally stopped, cut in stone a sign that read, "Abandon all hope, ye who plan to enter the land of the dead." I ain't, but as they marched forward, George's tail became caught in a tiny tree.
La la la, Luke! Luke, I am your father!
Luke, I am your father.
We all loved her in Sex and the City.
Barbie doll perfection kind of thing that Sex and the City promotes. And a lot of...
Hi, I'm Royce Gracie, and I'm back to defend my title as the Ultimate Fighting Champion.
That's a lot of family to beat, Brian.
What do you recall most about that fight with Royce Gracie?
Well, I was in severe pain.
When you get down to quantum physics, and this is one of the reasons that Bohm came up with the holographic idea, it starts to have real effects. And one of those is it's been discovered that if you take two subatomic particles like electrons, and in certain instances, when you do something to one, it will always affect the other, no matter how far apart they are. It's kind of like stories that you've heard of identical twins where when one is hurt, the other feels the pain.
If you take a hologram image and cut it in half or in quarters or in tenths, each time you reduce it in size, the image becomes fuzzier and fuzzier, even though the whole image is there, just the way memory would seem to be.
Now, it's a great puzzler to well-trained Christians to come across the trickster hero, because he's both a kind of devil and fool and the creator of the world. And so he comes in as an upsetting factor. He breaks through. He even breaks through the notion of what a deity ought to be. And this, I think, is about as good an example as you can find anywhere of the trickster hero. Now, that trickster trait turns up in deities like Yahweh. Yahweh's a trickster. He lets people build a building, and then because it gets to be three stories high, he afraid it's going to wreck heaven, and he comes down and floods the world. That's a trickster stunt. That's a ridiculous act. And we think it quite normal for a deity to behave that way. If a human being behaved that way, we'd send him to a lunatic asylum. And here you have the deity coming through as the trickster, as the destroyer, as the disruptor of programs. Yahweh's full of this kind of thing.
My mom always said, life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get.
What is it, relay? What's going on here? You got the system for total control. Now is there anybody out there? Now watch yourself for you, cause we can't go. What is it really that is in your head? What little life that you had just died? I'm gonna be the one that's taking over. Now this is what it's like when worlds collide.
Are you ready to go? Cause I'm ready to go. What you gonna do, baby, baby? Are you going with me? Cause I'm going with you. That's the end of all time.
What is it really that motivates you? The need to fly or this fierce star? Now who's a liar and who is the devil? You can't decide, so I'll be your guide. And one by one they will be hand chosen. Now this is what it's like when worlds collide.
Difference UTC time and CERN time. It was exactly at the same time.
This is what it's like when worlds collide. Now this is what it's like. Now this is what it's like when worlds collide.
If you have a golf ball-sized consciousness, when you read a book, you'll have a golf ball-sized understanding. When you look out, a golf ball-sized awareness. And when you wake up in the morning, a golf ball-sized wakefulness. But if you could expand that consciousness, then you read the book, more understanding. You look out, more awareness. And when you wake up, more wakefulness. It's consciousness. And there's an ocean of pure, vibrant consciousness inside each one of us. And it's right at the source and base of mind, right at the source of thought, and it's also at the source of all matter.
UCC, Uniform Commercial Code, it's the Bible of business on the earth. When you are born, you come out of your mother's water. Therefore, you must have a birth certificate, a certificate of manifest. I'm telling you that until you understand the laws, the symbols, the emblems, what these words mean, you're never going to suspect how far gone we really are. Did you know, for instance, that your birth certificate is a security on the stock exchange in the New York stock market?
Now, what they did here, this is exactly what he meant when he said, soon every American will be required to register their biological property. Now, your parents didn't realize what they were doing when they filled this out, and these didn't exist before 1933. Birth records were recorded in scripture, and these only came into being in 1933 when they hatched this plan. They created a corporate fiction with a name just like yours. In doing this, they registered and monetized the spirit and soul of a living being. And you are held as collateral to secure the debt which our government owes to international bankers. So you and me and all these people here are actually collateral, and we don't even own our lives. We are chattel, and we believe we're free.
This is all done through a form of word magic. A simple perversion of language has made it possible to convince people around the world that these alternative laws apply to them. Just look at the similarities of warehouse receipts and birth certificates. Both document the date of issue, a serial number, registration number or receipt number, a description of the product, and an authorized informant to notify the appropriate government agency. With all of this information being readily available, the majority of people are unaware of their involvement with maritime admiralty law. This is possible through the manipulation of language. This admiralty law changed the meaning of the word person from a natural living person to a corporation.
Your schedule, your desktop, your details, your life. Show us your children, your photos, your home. Here, take credit, take insurance, take a loan. Get a job, get a pension, get a haircut, get a suit. Playing the lottery, play football, play the field, or some toot. We'll show you dream, we'll show you sleep, we'll buy you dream, we'll be your blue. We'll sell you crap, we'll charge you debt. Wanna buy big guns in the front of cash? We
Our citizenship begins when we board the citizen ship, which sails the high seas carrying the seamen. And it all begins when the male ship docks in the female slot or slip, also known as its berth, and unloads the cargo, or the seamen, which sail up the waters of the canal. So she then gets pregnant and now carries the precious cargo and will give birth to the new citizen, which must now register to board that citizen ship and repeat the cycle all over again.
Technology changes everything.
there's this enormous mystery waiting to be unlocked.
We're heading into a very strange world.
Humanity is just going to become something that we look back on.
The technology is already here, and it's already being developed around the world.
Computer chips, GPS technology, the internet. They change our lives in ways that we could never have imagined.
They're actually connecting their neural network to machinery.
We are about to unfold the story of Frankenstein, a man of science who sought to create a man after his own image.
That was giving these people superhuman-like abilities.
We can do things that we're not really supposed to do as humans.
You will undo humans as they were made by God.
Another very interesting thing, as you know, Mother Nature uses all kinds of mathematical languages. That when we go to understand physical phenomena, we generally find that there's some sort of mathematical underpinning to whatever the phenomena is. There are uncountable mathematical languages. It turns out that the mathematical language involved in the making of a hologram is a system of mathematics developed by a French man named Fourier. They're called Fourier transforms. Well, it also turns out that our brain uses Fourier transforms to translate visual information. And this is a very unusual state of affairs. It's kind of like discovering Eskimos speaking Spanish. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not proof that the brain is a hologram, but it's suggestive that the brain is a hologram. And it turns out, in fact, all of our senses appear to rely on sort of Fourier transforms, that they all seem to use the same mathematics. So again, here's evidence that the brain uses the same mathematics to decipher the sensory world as you're involved in the making of a hologram, which is, as I say, not proof, but compelling evidence that something is going on.